Kevin, good morning to everybody. We'll wait a second. I'll just talk a little bit, Mike, till we get tuned in. Pretty good?
We're good.
Back, thumbs up, you can hear. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen?
Amen.
I know it's not in the bulletin. Sometimes as Reformed people, we have a bit of spontaneity in us. And it just kind of comes. What a beautiful morning. We've had some rain in the area, and it's overcast, but it doesn't look like rain, at least according to radar, presently, and we're rejoicing that we can be together on this Sunday morning under the tent. I've been waiting for this for a while because people told me we do this, and I wanted to see how big the tent is. I see it's kind of a circus color of sorts, But we're here to worship God, aren't we?
Amen.
We're here to praise Him and let Him know that in our hearts we esteem Him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And it's so good to see all of you. I don't know, under the tent, do we say the braver ones have sat outside the tent? Or do we just say they slept in longer? Take your pick. But we're all here to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. And I was perusing our bulletin a little while ago this morning, and there is so many opportunities on here for you to serve the Lord at and through Over Isel Church. So let me encourage you to read over some of these, especially with our fall ministries kicking off in a little over a month or so, and there's so much that we do here as a congregation, for our congregation and for the community as well. So please consider this. Second of all, it is Communion Sunday, and we are going to partake of the Lord's Supper following the message / meditation this morning. Next Saturday is the Over Isel Community Celebration, and one of our chairpersons, Mike Verkijk, will come forward now and share a little bit, Mike, of what's to transpire next weekend.
Morning.
Morning.
I think, can you hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, good. It's like quiet up here. It's weird. here we are under the tent. Saturday is the event. We're looking forward to it. The forecast is the weather's going to be 75 degrees, so it's going to be beautiful. We do have lots of opportunity yet for people to serve. I know we always get a great turnout the day of. People come, people do. But it would be nice if we could get a couple more of you to sign up and say, hey, I'm willing to do this stuff, because then we can plan on it, and it takes a little bit of stress off the event coming up to it. But a couple other things is invite your neighbors. See if they want to come. Have them come. It's free. It's an opportunity. It's fun. And it's an opportunity to get to know people. Number two, make an effort to get to know people. Reach out to the neighbors. Reach out to the people you're not seeing. It's not an opportunity to say, oh, come to our church. It's more of an opportunity to say, hey, here we are. We are Over Isel Reformed Church. We are part of this community. We are there. And I guess third, and this is really probably should have been number one, the most important, but pray for this activity this week.
Mm-hmm.
Pray that God's going to work through it. Pray that God's going to be in the middle of it, and pray that He will be praised as a result of what happens, whatever happens and however it comes off. So we're looking forward to it, and thank you again.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mike, and the whole team involved with planning the Over Isel Community Celebration. Now I ask a question. Look around briefly. Tell me what you see and hear and observe. Just shout out a few things. What's one thing you see?
God's creation around us.
God's creation. Birds.
Trees.
Mosquitoes. We might hear a few swats this morning. I think you can use your bulletins to do that too. What else? Anything else? What's that?
Friends,
yes. Newer friends and older friends. So we're under the tent, but we're in creation. And I want to call us to worship with these words from Jesus Christ found in the Gospel of Matthew. Now Jesus began to teach them, saying this, "Therefore, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow or reap or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not much more valuable than they? And who of you, by worrying, can add a single hour to his or her life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin, yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God so clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow thrown into the oven for cooking, how much more will he clothe you, O you of little faith? So do not say, 'What shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear?' For the pagans seek after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own." This is the word of God. Thanks be to the Lord. Let us worship God.
As we begin our time of singing, you are welcome to stand or to sit. We'll be nice and informal as we're outside. If you do not have a song sheet, they are on the tables. That'd also be a great chance to grab communion cups if you forgot those. I apologize to those who are online, as there won't be any slides on your screen, but the songs should be familiar enough for you to be able to join along. All creatures
of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise him, hallelujah. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
The rushing wind,
thou rushing wind that art so strong, ye clouds that sail in heaven along, oh, praise him, hallelujah. Thou rising moon in praise rejoice, ye lights of evening find a voice. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Let all things
their Creator bless, and worship him in humbleness. Oh, praise him, hallelujah. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
testifies.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation's revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God.
Who has told?
Who has told every lightning bolt where it should go? Or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow? Who imagined the sun and gave source to its light? Yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. None can fathom, indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God.
All-powerful,
all-powerful, untamable, awestruck we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim. You are amazing, God.
Indescribable,
indescribable, uncontainable. You place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God.
Incomparable,
incomparable, unchangeable. You see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. Sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
You can be seated.
What a great God we have been worshiping, and we will continue to worship God now in prayer. Would you join with me, please, as we turn to our great God in prayer? Heavenly Father, we have been singing about your greatness and your majesty. The Bible says that a long time ago, in the very beginning, you created the heavens and the earth. And the Bible says that from the rising of the sun to the place where it sets, your name is to be praised. And the scriptures teach us that day to day pours forth speech and night to night declares knowledge. And there is no language among all the nations of the earth where your voice is not heard in creation. And as we're concluding our global Olympics with all the nations of the earth that participate involved, and all the languages and all the cultures. There is witness to your existence. There is witness to your divine power in nature, in creation, in the human body, in how you have made us and formed us within our mother's womb. Evidence, O God, for your existence is everywhere, from the blade of grass to the bumblebee, from the zebra to zoology. The creation bears witness. The conscience bears witness. Human beings bear witness to the very existence of the invisible God. But we thank you, Lord, that in Jesus Christ, we see the invisible God made visible. We see Jesus in real time. If there had been smartphones or video or cameras, there would have been pictures and footage of Jesus Christ. But you ordained it that he would come pre-technology, that we might trust not what we see on television or read on the internet, but trust what the Word of God teaches us, that you did indeed walk on water even as you stomped the serpent's head, that you indeed cleansed the leper even as you cleanse our sins, us from sin this communion morning. Oh, Jesus, where can we stop? We can't stop talking about how great and wonderful and loving and kind and tender you are to weak men and women like us. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. And how we want to pray as a congregation this morning for those with unique needs. We pray for Valora Van Vuren recovering from back and hip pain and ask you to be with her in a very special way. We pray for Goldie Sternberg, along with Larry and Betty Sternberg, and the whole family over the loss of a son and brother and brother-in-law, and the family is in grief, Lord, but we thank you for Dave's testimony, and we pray that you would comfort them with the hope of the resurrection. We thank you, Lord, for great support for the projects that we need to do as a congregation. We take, for example, the parking lot that was finished this week, and we thank you for the support for the ministry of Overijssel Reformed Church, 1848 to 2021 and going strong, hallelujah. And we pray for those in the Overijssel congregation who are serving in one way or the other the United States of America. Drake Fogarty, Sean Mather, Kyle Theodore, Adam Vorhorst. And we bless you, O God, that you are with them while they are far away serving our land. And so we thank you, God, that we can come to you and worship you. We thank you that upon confessing our sin, you are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So thank you, God, that as we hear your word in a few minutes and as we come to this table, we can know and reassure our hearts before you whenever they condemn us, for you are greater than our heart. Thank you, Jesus, for that glorious death and resurrection. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Sun and moon and stars.
church that evermore lifteth holy hands above, offering up on every shore her pure sacrifice of love. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For thyself, best gift divine, to the world so freely give. For that great, great love of thine, peace on earth and joy in heaven. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. Lord of all, to thee we raise this our hymn of grateful praise.
And to those wonderful words and that worship, we say amen to the great God and Father. Pray with me as we come to that time in our service when we hear God's word. Oh, Lord, thank you so much for the word of God. Thank you so much for the word of creation. Thank you so much for being a speaking God. You are not mute like deaf and dumb idols, according to the Bible. You are alive. You are living. Jeremiah says that you are the true God, the living God, and the everlasting King. At your wrath, the earth quakes and the nations cannot endure your indignation. Oh God, you have stretched out the heavens and you have created the breath of every man, woman, and child. We bow before this sacred truth this morning, drawing our life, drawing our breath from you. And yet, in addition to this, we hear Jesus tell us that we do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And we want your mouth to speak, Lord. For you tell us in Proverbs chapter 8, from my mouth comes righteousness. And there is nothing twisted or crooked that comes from my mouth. So we look forward to hearing what you have for us today. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, it's a delight to be with you here and to open up God's word for the minutes we have together and to celebrate Holy Communion. Saturday nights are one of my favorite nights of the week because, as my wife has known for the better part of 31 years, that's what when I kind of, I don't know, if I was parachuting into the congregation with a sermon on a Sunday morning, Saturday night would be about 50 feet above the earth, and I'm ready to go and just drop down and do what God wants me to do. It's been a joy for me to preach for many years now, and I've done it in Africa. I've preached in Russia. I've preached in Israel and Turkey. I've preached in Holland, and I think maybe I like Holland best. Although I've preached on the south side of Chicago, I've preached in northwest Iowa, and I want to preach until I can't. And my wife knows that someday she might see me die of a heart attack in the middle of a sermon. And I think we're all right with that. You'd have to ask her. The policy's paid, don't worry about it. All kidding aside, I still am humbled by this great privilege. And I think there's two things that led me to Psalm 16:11 this morning. One, I hope, God, pastors pray about these things, and we ask God to lay something on our heart. So I hope this is from God. And number two, God wants to encourage you. I want to be an instrument of encouragement this morning, so that you and I together stay on the path of life. God wants you this morning, no matter where you are in your Christian journey, to stay on the path of life. And if you haven't begun the Christian journey yet, God wants you to step away from the path of death onto the path of life. And we're drawn to that fairly well-known 11th verse of Psalm 16. Some years ago, I memorized the 16th Psalm because I needed to know God is still my refuge. Some years ago, I memorized Psalm 16 because I needed to know the boundary lines have fallen for me in pleasant places. Some years ago, I needed to memorize Psalm 16 because I needed to know verse 11. Hear the word of God. You have made known to me the path of life. In your presence, there is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. This is the word of the Lord. I say again that God wants to encourage you this morning to stay on the path of life. Too many people are leaving the church today. It's not only those who turn 18 and grow their own wings and begin to fly away and say, maybe someday I'll come back to the church. It's people in midlife who've grown weary and tired of Christianity. And it's some who are much older who are saying, I've had enough of the church. Well, that goes against everything Jesus wants for his disciples. After all, Jesus says in the 16th chapter of Matthew, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. So why would you want to leave the church when the gates of hell will not prevail against the church? But the gates of hell will prevail in other ways. It doesn't make any sense on an intellectual level. And it certainly doesn't make any sense on an eternal level. I want to give you three reasons from verse 11 to stay on the path of life. They're right there before you. They're simple, they're clear, not hard to understand. A little five-year-old can understand this. And I like speaking to five-year-olds. Do we have any five-year-olds in the house of the Lord today? Any five-year-olds? No five-year-olds. We need five-year-olds at Over ISIL. We do have a five-year-old? Okay, we do have one, a Flockster over there. Well, we need more five-year-olds. Are you guys done having children? Number one, stay on the path of life. Because the path of life is real. Listen, you have made known to me the path of life. You see, the path of life is something that God has made known. You've known it since you were so very young. I'm so distressed by what I read today about what children, sometimes kindergarten and first grade, are being told about humanity and human life at educational levels. It strikes against all that God intends for our young children at that age. God has made known the path of life. The path of life is real. There's a real path of life. And I'm not talking now, nor is the text, about your job, your marriage, or whom you may marry someday, or where you might go to college, or where do you decide to live, or how to make a living. That's part of the path of life. That's within the path of life. But the path of life itself is even bigger than that. The path of life, friends, is what God has revealed in His Word through His only Son, Jesus Christ. There's a reason why Jesus said in the upper room in John 14, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. Jesus was saying that he is the path of life, and Christ is revealed in all the Bible that you and I might know how to follow the path of life. So the first simple truth this morning is this. Stay on the path of life because the path of life is real. Listen, there is a path of life. This takes the guesswork out of living life. As a young person, or perhaps even tipping toward your senior years of life, you don't have to scratch your head and say, I wonder what life is all about. You don't have to scratch your head and say, I wonder who made it all. You don't have to scratch your noggin and say, I wonder what's at the end. All of that is clearly made known in this book called the Bible, the Scriptures, the Word of God, the truth of God, the living, breathing witness of God. Stay on the path of life because it's a real path. Do you think God would have created this amazing masterpiece? I see Shanley and Ezra right over here. Would God have created the masterpiece of human beings, of creation, and left us without a path of life? Of course not. The path of life is Jesus Christ, and he heralds his word to all the nations of the world, beckoning sinners to come to him, to repent of their sin, and find salvation in him. But friends, I also forewarn you, just as there is a path of life, there is also a path of death. And do you know that God has set before the human race the path of life and the path of death? Listen, I was reading a few days ago in Jeremiah 21:8. And in Jeremiah 21:8, God says, I set before you the way of life and the way of death. And then I started thinking, did you do that, God? And he impressed upon my heart, of course I did, Mike. Go back to the Garden of Eden. I've been setting the path of life and death before humanity from the very beginning of time. For in the garden, I created the tree of life. And alongside it, I created the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And I said, you can eat from the tree of life, but not from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. From the very beginning, God sets before you and me the path of life in Jesus Christ. It hasn't changed. And so today, the path of life and death are before you. And the path of life and death will be for us until the end of time when Christ comes. And so there's a choice to be made. Now, faith, says the Bible in Romans 10:17, comes from what is heard, and what is heard from the preaching of Christ. I remember as a young boy, 5 and 10 and 15, growing up at Peace Reformed Church in Eagan, Minnesota. I remember sometimes being very tired as a high school student for the worship service on Sunday morning because I was out late at a hockey game in some other town or hanging out with my buddies or whatever. But I remember when I got to that church on Sunday morning and Pastor George walked up to the pulpit with his three-piece suit and tie. He would open the Bible, and every Sunday he would read a passage from the Bible, and then he'd preach on the Bible. So we would understand what the Bible meant. And then after church, he'd shake our hands. And then during the week, he'd come and visit us. And that became my model of a pastor. You preach, you visit people, you greet, and you point people to the Lord like Pastor George pointed us in Minnesota many, many years ago. You have a choice today. Choose life, cries Joshua, or choose death. So number one, very simple. Stay on the path of life because the path of life is real. You're going to have so many fake paths, so many false paths, so many dangerous paths, whispering, calling, and I could name them now, but we won't. It's communion morning. I don't want to go too long. But you know what they are. They're out there. They stalk us. They whisper, oh, it won't hurt that bad. You see, the path of life was actually spoken by Jesus, wasn't he? He said, enter through the narrow gate. For wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate, and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few enter it. Number one, stay on the path of life because the path of life is real. Number two, stay on the path of life because the path of life leads to fullness of joy. You have made known to me the path of life. In your presence is what? Fullness of joy, writes the psalmist to conclude this great psalm. Fullness of joy. Simply amazing, isn't it? That God has made us to be joy carriers. That God has made the heart with emotions and feelings and distractions and ups and downs. We know what it's like to be depressed, don't we? We know what it's like to take our Ritalin on a daily basis. We know what it's like to be weary and fatigued. We know what it's like to have children who are somewhere on the spectrum. Autism, ADHD, Asperger's, whatever it is. We know what it's like as human beings to be hurt by others, to be betrayed by loved ones. We know what it's like to experience pain in our heart. God has made us so all of that is possible. Humans are not robots. Evolution at the macro level isn't true because God did not make you a blob of cells. He made you in his divine image. And that's why Christ came. And so in God's presence, there is fullness of joy. So here it is. Walk on the path of life and you're walking with God. You're walking with the Lord, and he will pour into your heart joy. Isn't it the psalmist who says in Psalm 4, you have put gladness in my heart more than when their grain and new wine abound? In other words, that's the Bible's way of saying the gladness of Jesus in the human heart is greater than anything this life can ever give us. So let's think about it for a moment. What does it mean this morning, friend, for you and me to stay on the path of life because the path of life leads to fullness of joy? Well, first of all, think with me of the joy of obedience. I can't tell you because most of you know that there's no joy in this world like obedience to the Lord, following his ways. You know that when we deviate to the right or deviate to the left or stop and turn around and do a 180 to go backwards, all of a sudden we start feeling these sharp pains of sadness, of guilt, of heaviness, of burden. That's because we've turned away from the path of life, obedience to the commands of God. But God has given you his commands that not simply that you might follow his commands, but that in so following, joy would fill your heart. Now get this. Don't follow the commands of God, no joy in human life. Follow the commands of God, joy in human life through Christ. That's the teaching of the Bible. And isn't it something? Don't you just sort of shake your head sometimes when you read about the vast throng of people today who are caught up in opioids, caught up in all sorts of dangerous habits and time-wasting activities, and they've strayed from the path of life, and they're hurting themselves, and they're hurting us as family members, and perhaps you this morning. Why would you seek joy in a hit of marijuana when you can have the joy of Jesus Christ hit every moment of every day? Why would you want more drugs or more alcohol or more this or that when fullness of joy is on the path of righteousness? The joy of obedience will always ring true. Number two, how about the joy of fellowship with Jesus? Now, I'm not going to get into any of your spiritual lives at that level, but let's just say this. Your fellowship, which is your relationship, in action. Our fellowship with Jesus Christ is the sweetest thing on earth, isn't it? When you and I are in trouble, we say, oh, Jesus, I need you. When you or I are scared, we say, oh, Jesus, I need the courage of David when he had his stones and he flung them at the giant. You see, when we go through difficult times, when we're in the foxhole, we need Jesus. But you know what? There are probably many of you this morning who don't have an achy hip, who don't have a sore knee, who aren't wrestling with forgetfulness, and you're just doing fine physically, and your job is doing well, and you like where you're at in life. There's joy in that too, right? You see, joy is deeper than trials, wider than normal life. Joy is Jesus in the heart. Remember, J-O-Y spells joy, kids. And here's how you can always have joy, even though sometimes it's hidden and masqueraded by our hardships. J-O-Y, Jesus first, others second, yourself third. That's joy in serving others first. Hallelujah. How about the joy of the promises of God? Count your blessings, name them one by one. Promises of God. You bank on them, don't you? You know, someday there could be a run of the stock market again. Housing prices could dip to record lows. I could go to my bank someday like you and like Jimmy Stewart and the miracle story at Christmas, and there was no more cash. Remember that? What if that happened? Would the joy of Christ leave us? Well, there'd be a little wrestling match going on, no doubt. But it won't leave you. You know why? Because the joy of Jesus is deeper than our trials and hardship. Maybe the best joy of all, maybe, and I think one we struggle with, is this, the joy of forgiveness. I think sometimes in our Reformed faith, we think of joy or forgiveness like this. God, be merciful to me, a sinner, cried the tax collector, and he was forgiven. And we think we have to go along with a frown all the time. Or like, as good Reformed people, we're baptized not in water, but with lemon juice. No. There is no greater joy than to confess and receive forgiveness of sins. You don't have to linger forever in the guilt and the shame of that. You've confessed it to the Lord. It's forgiven. That's what David discovered a year after his adulterous affair with Bathsheba. Oh, David, naughty king that you were. David saw her bathing. He looked longer than he should have. He even looked. And he got caught in adultery. He had her husband murdered. Their child died. And oh, but David just went about life as everything was normal for about a year. Then the bony-fingered prophet Nathan with that long index finger pointed right at him a year later on God's command and said, David, after telling that parable of the sheep, you are the man. And David, for the first time in a year, came to grips with what he did, wasn't hiding it, wasn't covering his tracks anymore, wasn't pretending he wasn't guilty. He said in Psalm 51, the psalm of confession and joy, oh God, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are just in your judgments. And yet, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Let me rejoice in God my Savior. I mean, that's joy of forgiveness. Are you joyful this morning as you come to this table? When you drink this cup and eat this bread, you can be so joyful that God has forgiven you. It's serious. But don't forget the joy. If you forget the joy, you lessen the work of the cross, don't you? Oh no, the cross brings joy to those who confess. Lastly, stay on the path of life, my friends, because the path of life leads to fullness of joy. The path of life is real. But finally, but certainly not least, the path of life will pay off. Say that with me. The path of life will pay off. Are you ready for this? You have made known to me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy. Now here it comes. At your right hand are what? Pleasures forevermore. God made you to seek pleasure. God designed your heart and your soul to seek pleasure. And there's sinful pleasures that last for a millisecond and leave you feeling so tainted and filthy and dirty. And then there's godly pleasures that all flow out of Christ. You see, Christ died to purchase pleasure for you. And what the psalmist is saying is that this path of life that we're on, this path of life will pay incredible dividends. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Well, what's up with the right hand? I thought God was a spirit. He didn't have a body. God is a spirit. God doesn't have a body. It's a metaphor. God made human beings with bodies, and most people are dominant with their right hand. It's a figure of speech. When the Bible says, at your right hand are pleasures forevermore, God doesn't have a right hand, but I'll tell you who does. Jesus. That's why he came to earth. He made the invisible God visible, that we might look at Jesus and say, that's God. Not just Joseph, the carpenter's son. That's God in human flesh. And the right hand is a symbol of power and victory. And Hebrews 8 says that Jesus is seated where? At the right hand of God, the majesty in heaven. So when the text says, at your right hand are pleasures forevermore, it's saying Jesus died, he lives, in Jesus is pleasure plentiful. Treasure Jesus all the days of your life until you dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Forever. We grew up in the Twin Cities, the suburbs of Minneapolis, St. Paul. My grandma lived in Grand Rapids. And every year we'd come to visit grandma, first in her home on Garfield Avenue. We'd worship at Garfield Park Reformed Church where she sang in the choir. And then on Saturday nights, grandma would have us all sit down after the meal and we'd watch a show called Lawrence Welk. Anybody remember Lawrence Welk? Anybody remember Kitty and how she could dance around and all the great singers? Well, we're three young boys. And we, you know, a couple bubbles is enough. But too many bubbles. Grandma, can we go play? And she'd go, be back in early. Don't go out far, because tomorrow morning we're going to church. And we'd go in church, go to church with grandma. And I still remember that as a little boy. I can't remember a single sermon I heard. But the routine and the pattern of church is still with me to this day. I broke with it for a little while. I didn't go to church every Sunday in college like my son does. I'm so proud of him. He's got one up on his dad in college already. But I'll tell you what, the rhythm of college and worship and life has never left me. You see, when we look to the right hand of Jesus, now hear me on this. Your soul is designed for pleasure, but so easily today we're settling for sinful pleasure or meaningless pleasures, and we're not building. We're not, if you could see Jesus like this for a moment, if all the pleasures of the eternal God are in Jesus, and he has them for us to come, and even now and then, we're beginning to experience it now and we'll experience it forever then. If that's true, then Jesus is like a massive treasure chest. And he's that treasure chest. And what does a pirate or a person do with a treasure chest? They break open that key, that lock, whatever they can, they open up and they dive in and they look. And the Lord of the Rings, the dragon, covered all the treasure. The fire-breathing dragon would allow no one to have the gold and all the silver. And what I'm telling you, you could have, now this is, I could quote it, but I'm going to give you a paraphrase. You could have the whole world of earthly treasure and miss Jesus. But if you have Jesus, you have eternal pleasure, beginning now and lasting forever. So why would we want to stray from the path of life? Stay on the path of life. Stay on the path of life, because the path of life is real as the path of death. The path of life will lead to fullness of joy. And the path of life will pay off. It will pay off forever and ever and ever. And all of God's people say, amen. Lord Jesus, you are alive. You have conquered sin and death for your people. And we are here doing our part. We're singing some songs. We're fellowshipping. We're hearing the word, oh Lord, and we're honoring you. And now we come to the table. Oh Jesus, would you please feed us? We are hungry. Would you please give us drink? For we are thirsty. And would you assure us again that as we have this meal, that one of the greatest joys we can experience is the knowledge of sin forgiven. In your name we pray. Amen. Friends, Over Iceland Church family, this meal we are now to celebrate is a feast of remembrance, of communion, and of hope. We come to remember that our Lord Jesus was sent of the Father into the world to assume our flesh and blood and to fulfill for us all obedience to the divine law. We come to have communion with this same Christ who promises to be with us until the end of the age. In the breaking of the bread, he promises to be to us the bread of life. And in the drinking of the cup, he promises to be to us the true vine in whom we must bear fruit for eternal life. We also come in hope, believing that this bread and this cup are a pledge and foretaste of the life to come, when with unveiled face we shall behold Christ as he is. Mindful of this, let us come now to this table, having confessed our sins and knowing that God receives us for the gracious work of his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, this table is for you. Come, for all things are now ready. If you would peel back the tab of the juice or have it ready or get your bread out. This is the newer one. The bread which we break is the communion of the body of Christ. And the cup of blessing which we bless is the communion of the blood of Jesus Christ. Our Lord and our God, so simple, but so profound, that the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ forgives us of our sin and assures us of the forgiveness of our sin. And we thank you for feeding us through your word and at your table today. And all of God's people say, amen.
All of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint, let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, will be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, there will be justice, all will be new. your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. So we wait for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for a groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Like a bride waiting for a groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come.
Let's stand together. Beautiful, beautiful song. Here we are, the bride, longing for our King to return in glory. Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead the Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good for doing his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Our closing song is that proclamation. To God be the glory now and forever.
My friends, may you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior. My friends, may you grow in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. To God be the glory, now and forever, now and forever, amen. To God be the glory, now and forever, now and forever, amen.
Let's sing that one more time.
To God be the glory, now and forever, now and forever, amen. To God be the glory, now and forever, now and forever, amen.
Go in peace.